sorry. I wasn't.
No, that's okay.
Doesn't work, walk up to them.
Yeah.
To the big waterfall.
Good morning. Well, I don't know about you, but I've already put a day's work in. We are having wireless mic issues today, so keep lose anything else as I say this. Oh, goodness. Well, we are truly blessed that everyone is with us today. We welcome those who are watching online. And just a couple announcements that there will be a new members luncheon following today's service. So if you came to church hungry, that's okay because I'm pretty sure there's probably going to be enough food. But there will be no coffee hour. And I'm really disappointed that we're not going to have Dan's Bible study class today as well. Thursday's men's Bible study will be starting a study on Hebrews. All the men are welcome to join on Thursdays at 8:15 in the morning. At this time, we will do our new covenant.
I'm going to stay up here first so that you can hear me. How's that? I'll go from there. Well, we are here this morning to celebrate the formal covenanting of Button Smith and Dave and Lorraine Swigert with Calvary Presbyterian Covenant Partners. Bill and Cindy Heinzman will be brought into our formal fellowship with us next week. They had originally said that they could be here today, but a family event came up and they needed to be with family today, and we say amen to that. We say thank you for that as well. So they will be given the secret handshake and the secret decoder ring next week, and so we just want to say thank you, so we'll be able to meet them as well. But today we celebrate these individuals for desiring to be a part of our formal covenant, our formal church family. And, you know, the question is, why does it matter? Well, a covenant is simply a deep commitment to one another, sort of like a marriage is. It solidifies certain expectations that I don't have with someone who just wants to date me, quite frankly. And so that's the difference. The Bible's a series of covenants, if you don't know that. God made a covenant with Adam. He made a covenant with Noah, with Abram, with Moses and the people of Israel, with David through Jesus. He makes a covenant with us. That's what we're celebrating this morning with communion. It is a covenant, a new covenant that Jesus says that he's making in his blood. All of that is a symbolic gesture of a deeper relationship with each other. And we have other covenants, such as the covenant that David had with Jonathan, with Abraham and Abimelech, with Isaac and Phicol. There's a lot of horizontal covenants as well. All of those, once again, speak to a deep and abiding love of friendship and care for each other and for our extended family. And so that's really what covenant partnership is. It's just saying, you know what, God is moving me into a deeper relationship with these people. And I want to publicly affirm that. And so we're going to be talking about a two-partner covenant with each other, which means those folks that are coming are going to make a covenant with us, And we are going to make a covenant with them. That's how that works. And so I'm going to ask Buttons if you'll come, and Dave and Lorraine, if you'll just come up, and I'll try to use my theater voice as I come down so that you can all hear me as well.
Simple. Bill and Cindy asked me, what is
All right, let us take a moment of silent prayer as we come before our Lord and Savior. Father God, we thank you for your unmerited favor of your love. It is because of the faith you created in us that we may be saved. Set us apart to do your work and receive your grace. Sometimes we miss the mark and fall short of your will. Thank you for your grace when we falter in faith. We praise you for your grace upon grace. Father, for some of us, our strength is gone. But your word says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Give us the strength. Father, open our eyes not to see the world more clearly, but to see you. Open our eyes to see you working around us and in us. Nothing happens by accident. You orchestrate every day of our lives. Father, we know in Hebrews 11, it says, now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. Help us to trust in what we cannot see and believe in your invisible presence. We are miserable sinners. We know your will, but we are too weak to fulfill it. Our flesh and blood holds us back, and our enemy, the devil, will not leave us in peace. Help our unbelief. Your will is our desire. Place your word on our hearts and our minds. Build in us knowledge of your will. Make our heart's desire your heart's desire. Then we will rejoice in doing your work. Father, we have made plans, but the plans of God will prevail. Teach us to do your will. We pray for those covenant partners who are not with us today. We pray for the family of Mary Glacier. We pray especially for Bruce, Cheryl, and Eric and family. Wrap your loving arms around them. We know, Father, that this isn't a goodbye, but it's a see you later. Give the family strength in the coming days. Let them lean on you and know that you are near. We pray for those who have recently undergone surgery. We pray that you also give them strength. And Father, we pray for our new covenant partners that have joined us today. We pray that you work through both of us, that we can both have a lasting and loving relationship with you. Now we pray the prayer that Jesus taught the disciples by saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. down to the details, just go. And I can't imagine having that kind of faith. I don't know what I would be if the Lord tapped me on the shoulder and said, Dave, you're heading west. And I'll let you know when you get there.
Wonderful passage of scripture this morning, just one from the New Testament because of time's sake today. 2 Peter 3:13-14. A little emphasis on the words, so you can see the reduplication there. Let's read together. But in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. So then, dear friends, since you are looking forward to this, make every effort to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with him. Father, we come humbly before you this morning, thanking you for your kindness, I'm always mindful of Lamentations, the third chapter, that your mercies are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness to us, even when we have not been faithful to you. And so, Father, we ask that you'll bless your word. May your spirit take it, penetrate our hearts and our minds. Help us to think about the faith that we have before you and what it looks like when Christ comes for us. May it even be so today, Lord, that you would send your Son to take us from this world to be with you forever. It's our prayer, it's our hope, it's our longing. We ask it in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, please. Amen. You may be seated, church. Thank you so very much. In 2008, I was invited to go on an evangelism trip into Lebanon and Syria with a group of pastors. Our second day in Damascus, we were told to get our gear and to get into a van. Now, my passport was locked in the main safe at the hotel where we stayed in the lobby area. When you got to some place like that, they required all your passports. Was not real comfortable with that. And I asked, where are we going? You'll see, came the answer. Now, when you're in a very hostile country without your passport, getting into a white van, that's not the answer that you want to hear. Not that it would have mattered, because I wouldn't have known where it was I was going anyway. All I needed was someone to put a hood over my head, and it would have made my nightmare complete, and all God's people said, please. Well, we headed out into the eastern desert of Syria. No idea where my destination was. The only thing we saw were the occasional Bedouin and sheep and goat. And then we saw it. Deir Mamusa al-Habashi, the monastery of St. Moses the Abyssinian, 1,320 feet above sea level, and the only way was to climb what felt like a million rock-hewn stairs in 90-degree desert heat with backpacks, and I was recovering from a double ear, eye, and sinus infection from all the air pollution in Beirut. I can remember feeling very uneasy about the journey, but you see, I trusted our team leader because he knew where he was going. He'd been there before. And so I can only imagine how Abraham must have felt when God called him from his home and never told him where he was going. As Dave said, that had to take an incredible amount of faith. So as we continue our series, Faith, Will Jesus Find It? Our focus today will be on Abraham, the faith of a foreigner. The faith of a foreigner. Turn with me, please, to our primary text, if you would, in Hebrews chapter 11, verses 8 to 10, and then we're going to briefly look at Genesis chapter 12 for the actual account. Hebrews chapter 11, verses 8 to 10, if you'll read the highlighted for me, please. Shall we begin? Ready, church? By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, significant, even though he did not know where he was going. Church, by faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of that same promise. For he was looking forward, church, to the city with foundations, whose architect and builder is God himself. And now if we could look, please, at Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 to 5, we'll read the actual account. Genesis chapter 12, 1 to 5. The Lord had said to Abram, remember, at the covenant part in Genesis 15, God changed his name from Avram to Abraham. Avraham. Abram means father. Avraham means father of many. So there was a life change. Changed Sarah's name from Sarai to Church Sarah. All right? Changed Jacob's name, Yaakov, to Israel, one who wrestles with God. God is always changing names because some significant change in their life is taking place, and it's representing something different. So the Lord said to Avram, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse, and all peoples on earth will be blessed through you, Abram. So it's no surprise that the writer of Hebrews brings into the conversation of faith the man of whom the Apostle Paul would say was the father of all who believe by faith. So when the writer's Jewish audience was contemplating going back to that old form of dead ritual religion, the author reminds them that the promise of eternal life with God never came through the law, which happened 400 years later, by the way, but by grace through faith, as Abraham himself demonstrated. Now, Abraham is a bit of a mystery to me, church. The Bible tells me that he was from a very cultured, very modern city called the Ur of the Chaldeans, which is in present-day Iraq. I read this in a biblical archaeology review article years ago. They were doing a study on Ur of the Chaldees, and they said, did you know that they had flushing toilets and a sanitary system? Amazing, isn't it? And I still had to use that stupid old outhouse on the farm. What's wrong with us? Maybe we're not as wise as we thought we were. But Ur of the Chaldeans was a very, very metro area. So you need to understand that, because God is calling Abraham out of that. This is a very significant part of the story, church. The other thing that I've noticed is that Abraham is not like Enoch, and he's not like Noah. The Bible never tells us that when God called him, that he walked with God. It never tells us. In fact, it assures us that he wasn't a righteous man by those standards. Abraham was sort of that unmolded clay that God is calling out to do something very significant in his life. Abraham is in a, what we call a multi-false God system, or a polytheistic or a pantheistic religious society. And yet in the midst of that, he hears the voice of the one true God with such clarity, with such certainty, with such driving authority, that he picks up all of his possessions, grabs his father, grabs his nephew Lot and his family, and he heads out to a destination he has no idea where he's going. It's amazing that anybody went with him, to be honest with you. But I tell you what, when you're in the midst of a person that is so convinced that God has called him and has called him to a certain destination, that's very attractive, and all God's people said. When you hang out with people that have such certainty and such surety about the call of God in their life, those people attract me. It's like, wow, I wish God would speak to me that way. And there's something about that. There's something about the posture of that. It's shoulders back, up, face going, chin up, moving forward. Where are we going? I don't know. Do you want to come with me? Yeah. I'm going where you're going. I don't know where it's leading, but boy, the journey's going to be interesting. And all God's people said, please. Because that's what happens when somebody gets a clear word from God through the scriptures or through prayer. When God grabs a hold of you in with such passion, you can't get out from underneath of that. Why do you think the apostles, when they were before the Sanhedrin said, these are a bunch of idiot Galileans, they're fishermen, they're highly uneducated, they don't know what they're talking about. Why in the world are people following these people? I'll tell you why, because they had a clear, certain vision of Christ and a destination. They were attractive. Jesus was an attractive person, as in he attracted people. Why do you, have you ever thought about the mystery of this? Jesus is walking past a tax collector's booth, and he says, "Matthew, come follow me." And Matthew says, "I ain't going anywhere. I have no idea where you're going." That's not what Matthew said, was it? What happened? Matthew left everything and followed. Why is that? Why is it when he met John and Andrew? What was it about Jesus that captured them that said, "I think I need to follow that guy"? What about Peter and John in the temple when they raised up the lame man at the temple gates and they were just those dumb fishermen? Why did people start following them? I'll tell you why. Because they had a clarity, they had a certainty, a passion in themselves that just exuded and came out of them. Boy, wouldn't you wish to have that, church? I want that. I want that type of passion, not so that people would follow me, but that they would follow me as I follow Christ, as Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and 1. Amazing things to think about. Abraham is in the midst of a religious pluralistic society, and yet he hears that one true voice of God, and something happens and he leaves in obedience and takes his family who follows along for some unexplained reason for which I've been trying to gather my own thoughts on. The writer of Hebrews would have us to see four primary aspects of that type of faith today. So I want to review the scripture in Hebrews 11 and then expound on it if I could please. I've kind of color-coded a little bit as I always do so that you can see it a bit. I'm going to read through it one more time and then I'm going to give us some R's today. I went back to the old classic hermeneutics of giving you words that start with the letter R so that you can kind of remember it. But let's read once again Hebrews 11, 8 to 10. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, he did something immediately. What did he do, church? He obeyed and he went, even though he did not know where he was going, destination unknown. Verse 9, by faith, he made his home in the promised land, but he made his home like a stranger in a foreign country. He lived in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of that same promise. So it was not just Abraham that did this. It was his next two generations that lived like this, even though they had the promise of something. Verse 10, for he was looking forward, church, to the city with foundations whose architect and builder is God, the very God himself. I'm going to give you these four R's, but then I'm going to come back and give you some application points for ourselves. So if you're taking notes, this is not going to be on the screen, but I'll allude to them when I get to my final points as well. So the first aspect of Abraham's faith that I want you to see was that it was a responsive faith, a responsive faith. When called to go, Abraham didn't argue with God for the details. You're going to be very convicted about this, by the way, because I am as well. When Abraham was called to go, he didn't argue with God for the details. He didn't wait until it felt right or he had a sense of peace about it. And all God's people said, please. He obeyed and he went. He didn't delay. Immediate obedience is an outward expression of an unwavering faith. Let that resonate and sit in your spirit for a bit. Immediate obedience is an outward expression of unwavering faith. If God tells me to go, I go. Why? I have unwavering faith in God. The second aspect of Abraham's faith was that it was a reliant faith. A reliant faith. This to me is the most amazing thing about Abraham's faith. It's this raw, messy faith in a God who just showed up and spoke. God did not get a map of the area with a little arrow that said, you are here and your destination is here. In fact, Abraham didn't even know who this God was. That's where the first two points are so amazing to me, because something happened with Abraham where in the midst of that polytheistic system, Abraham recognized this is the true God. This is the voice that I need to hear. I have no clue who this God is, but he told me to do something, and by faith, I'm going to do it. Do you see the mystery in that, church? You see, we want to know everything, don't we? Well, I'll become a Christian when I figure out the Trinity. I got news for you. Well, I'll be a Christian when, you know, I get all my questions answered. I've got news for you. I've been in the faith since I was a child, and guess what I still have, church? I still have questions. And I still have questions about the most fundamental parts of my faith. Why? Because God has not chosen to give me the details. That's what faith is, by the way. Type of faith that goes against, church, a we need to know nature about ourselves. God, and I love this, I was thinking about this, God says to me, Dan, you're correct. This is a need to know assignment. And guess what? You don't need to know. You don't need to know. And there's a reason for that, because faith that sees first is not faith at all. The world says, show me and I will believe. Show me and I'll follow. And as Christians, we say, you know what, it doesn't work that way. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence, church, of things not seen. It's a person's utter dependence upon God that he really doesn't know. I don't know who you really are. I don't have all the information. I haven't done the download yet, God, but there's something about you that is resonating in my spirit. There's something that's moving me, that's making me passionate about who you are and desires to know you even at a greater level. God, I don't know what this is. I can't explain it, but God, you're moving in my life. And so by faith, I'm just going to keep taking steps. And that's exactly the type of faith that Abraham had. It's utter dependence upon a God that he didn't know. But with each step of obedience, he will come to know this God who has called. Isn't that the essence of relationships, by the way? You start a relationship, it's a bit mysterious. You spend time with each other, you know, and you grow. And Abraham is going somewhere. And that's good enough because God is leading him there. I want to give you an example of Abraham knowing God. When you get to the Genesis 18 and 19, you get the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. God says to Abraham, he says out loud actually to the host, shall I not share this thing with Abraham, who I'm going to make the father of all nations? And so Jesus and two angels show up to give Abraham the information that he's going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And what does Abraham do? He goes to this God and says, will you kill all those people if there are 50 people in that city? Now, that's an interesting question because it's designed to do what, church? Do you know what it's designed to do? It's designed to know God. God, are you righteous? Are you merciful? If there's just 50 people in that city, are you the type of loving, gracious, merciful, benevolent God to not destroy the city if there's 50 people there? And what did God say? Do you remember? If there's 50 people there, I won't destroy the city. And Abraham keeps doing the subtractive math, doesn't he? And he gets down to 10 people. Now that shouldn't be hard because there's Noah, his wife, and two daughters, and maybe their two son-in-laws who we don't know are believers. That's six. All he needs to do is go throughout the cities and pick up how many, church? He needs to pick up a subtotal of four. We can do this, can't we? Abraham can't find 10 more people in that city, but he was willing to save the city. That tells me something about God. That was the knowledge base that Abraham was trying to get about him. It wasn't about saving Sodom and Gomorrah. It was about Do I serve a God who is merciful and gracious and benevolent? Can I test him? Can I go to prayer and ask him? Can I intercede on people's behalf? And will God hear me? If he says yes to this, I like this God. And all God's people said, please. I think I like serving this God. I didn't know that about him, but I'm going to keep testing and asking and finding out who he is. That's what I'm going to be doing. Abraham is going somewhere, and that's good enough because God is leading him there. The third aspect of Abraham's faith was that it was a receiving faith without receipt. I qualified. It is a receiving faith without receipt. What do I mean by this? Abraham was given the promised land. He received that promise by faith, but he never took possession of it. For his entire life, he was living by faith as a stranger in a foreign country, a country that was his by divine decree. And yet through his entire life, he had very few rights in the land. He had very few privileges. He was looked upon with suspicion and often taken advantage of by the local people. But he lived there in faith of expectation that God would fulfill his word, even if he didn't live to see it. There is an interesting note, if you know the story, if you know the Abrahamic story, the interesting note is that there was only one piece of land that Abraham actually did buy. Do you know what it was? A funeral plot. It was a cemetery plot when Sarah died. And that's where he and all of his sons were buried. It was a place of death. That's the only place where Abraham purchased ground that was rightfully his to own. The last aspect of Abraham's faith was that it was a rewarding faith. Abraham was not just looking for a land. He was looking for a divine city whose designer and builder was God himself. This is important because Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob all lived in what, church? They all lived in tents. Abraham was not looking for another tent. Abraham was looking for a city, but a very unique city. It's a city that was not built by the hands of man. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they lived in transitory shelters, symbolically saying, there's something better out there. There's something better that man has no part of building. There's a place for us, a city where the walls will ultimately protect us, whose homes will give us rest. But one thing that was promised in this world was that he would be blessed. And Abraham, God said, I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you and I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing to all who bless you. You see, he could have stayed in Ur, in the city built by man, with all of those comfortable amenities. Or he could trust God by faith and receive more than he could ever think or imagine. By faith, Abraham believed God. And my question is, what about you? When Jesus comes again, will he find an Abraham-type faith in you? And to help us with that, I want to see if I can identify some practical aspects of that faith and give it some personal twists. Here's the first one. Do you immediately respond in obedience to the clear word of the Lord as he speaks to you in prayer or in the study of his word? Do you, keyword church, what are they? Immediately respond in obedience. Do you immediately respond in obedience to the clear word of the Lord as he speaks to you in prayer or in the study of the word? If you do, then you have an Abrahamic faith. Question, do I obey or do I delay? Do I obey or do I delay? Jesus encountered delayers in his ministry. Come, follow me, Jesus said. Answer, I will, but let me go first check out some land that I bought. come follow me. I will, but you know, I need to attend a family funeral first, and then all the inheritance stuff, selling the house, donating clothes, you know, Jesus. Come follow me. Oh, I will, but can I go back home and have a going away party with my family? Obey or delay? Are you a Christian full of excuses? Are you a Christian who hears the word of God and eagerly desires to please God? It's interesting, in Luke 9, Jesus says, if you delay, you're not fit to serve in the kingdom of God. Pretty harsh words. Second, do you respond in obedience to the word of the Lord without having to have all of the what, church? All of the details. Lord, we know that you're moving us to the next spiritual destination. It's hard, Lord, and we're not really sure of the path, but we trust you. Lord, we've been through some tumultuous waters as a church for a very long time, but we know that there's a destination, a greater place that you're trying to get us to. We just can't see it yet. We can sense it, but we can't get our hands around it yet. You're doing so many wonderful things, and we're so thankful, but there's something greater out there. We can't find it. We can't see it, but we trust you, Lord. Are you okay living in a need-to-know faith system? Is God putting you in a place where the destination is unknown so that you might know him by faith? You know, I was thinking about Dave's illustration with the GPS. We put that in our GPS, and we take a sigh of relief, don't we? And we get there. But there are a couple things that happen with GPSs. Deb and I, we were out visiting in Pennsylvania, and I had no idea where this gentleman lived, so we put it in the GPS. We were going, and it turned us here, turned us here, turned us there, pulled us into a cornfield. I'm pretty sure he doesn't live here. Address was right. GPS was wrong, wasn't it? On the way home from Pennsylvania, Deb put in the GPS to our daughter's house. We ended up at Grace College and Seminary. She hit the wrong button. Sometimes there's human error in that, isn't there? And all of a sudden, we get a little panicked because we didn't find ourselves where we thought the destination was supposed to be. I think that's a warning to us that don't presuppose the destination. God might have other plans for you, and all God's people said, please. He may have a different reroute that he needs to take you on. Is God leading you somewhere? Does the destination actually matter? Is it not the journey of getting to know God at a deeper level that truly matters? If you have that type of faith, then you have an Abrahamic faith. Third, are you living confidently with an unrealized promise from God? Then you have an Abrahamic faith. Lord, your word is promised. I can't see this happening in my lifetime, but I believe it as if it's already happened, Lord. I believe it with such certainty. Lord, you've promised in your word that, now I want to do a caveat here because a lot of churches go side left and head into error on this. This isn't the demonic name it and claim it propaganda of the health, wealth, and prosperity gospel. This isn't praying for the larger house, the bigger car, the bank account. It's not taking God's word and using it to bind up God as if you were God and he's your servant and you've got to do it, God, because you said it. And It's that attitude, that sinful attitude that makes God our spiritual genie. That is not what this is talking about. This is about looking at the promises of God that he's given to me so that I can be more like Christ, so that I can be more in love with God himself. This is about me being more like Jesus. It's about me praying for the salvation of my family and friends and knowing that God hears those prayers. It's about the assurance that I have when death comes that I will be saved from the fires of hell because I have placed my trust in faith in Christ as my Lord and Savior, and God has promised me that. See, all the things that these prosperity gospel people pray for, that's all going to be burned up anyway. Why does it matter? It doesn't. By the way, try using that in third world nations. So it's about the promise that Jesus will rapture me out of this world and take me to himself. And so many of those other promises that are yet to be fulfilled. Abraham didn't see the promise fulfilled, but he believed as if he did. So if you've got a promise that you've been hanging onto in the scriptures, and you're wondering, when is God going to fulfill that promise? And if you are confident in hanging on to it with such certainty that God is going to do it, he may not do it in your lifetime. He may do it in heaven. I don't know how God is going to do that. But if you're holding on to that unfulfilled promise with such certainty and not falling prey to a sinful attitude toward God or falling prey into a name it, claim it type thing, then you have the faith of Abraham himself. Lastly, are you looking for an eternal city with foundations whose architect and builder is God? Paul said to the Colossians, set your hearts on things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. I was thinking about this week as I was meditating on the message that the Spirit of God laid upon my heart. And the question came to me, Dan, are you spiritually living in a tent, or are you trying to build your own house? Do you want something firm and stable here? And are you willing to give that which God has for you up in order for you to get it in this life? I see and have come across so many Christians, church, to my chagrin, that live like there's no heaven. Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we what, church? We die. And how many church people live like that? They live like it in this world. And I'm not talking about not having the things that God enjoys us to have. He enjoys giving his kids good things and nice things to enjoy in this world. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about living for those things as if there were no heaven to enjoy. And I read an article once about John Wesley, John Charles, who's part of my dissertation. Do you know when he died, he had a pocket watch, an eating spoon, and a few books? That's all he had. He had a rented house. I don't know how many horses he rode to death, but that's all he had. That, to me, is a man who knew that there was a city that he was heading to whose architect and builder was God, and that he was not going to invest in the things of this world, but he was going to invest in eternal things that counted and mattered. And all God's people said with me, please. Yeah, we need to have a heart like that, church. That's what God has. Are you a citizen of heaven who's just passing through, anticipating those streets of pure gold like glass? Are you looking for gates made out of a single pearl? Are you looking to drink eternal water from the river of life, coming into the throne of life, which is God himself? Are you looking to heaven where there's no death, no sickness, no sin, no suffering? Are you looking for a city whose place is peace and rest? Then you have that faith of Abraham. Do you remember that old song, This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. How did the rest, remember the next verse, church? The things I've laid up are up beyond the blue. Do you know the end of that song? It says this, and I can't be at home in this world anymore. What a great song that is. And that's our spirit. That's an Abrahamic faith, church. Well, where does it start? Because God might be calling you today to go on a journey with him. A journey toward an eternal life with him if you've not received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Or a journey with him because you have, but you've not left the Ur of the Chaldeans. He's not going to give you all the details. He wants you to come to him. But it starts with you responding to him in faith. Lord, I can't see, but I believe. Let's think about that as we participate in the Lord's Supper together, shall we? Let's close in prayer. Father, we love you. Thanks for your goodness to us today. Give us the faith of Abraham, we pray. Help us to be people that obey immediately because there's such clarity of your voice and such passion that's overwhelming us like no other religion that we've ever been a part of, because it's not a religion, it's a relationship with God. Help us to be that type of person that attracts others because we have an Abrahamic type of faith, that we're not really mindful of the details. We're interested in the journey, Lord, of being with you and part of who you are, of getting to know you on a daily basis. Lord, let us respond. Let us rely upon you, Lord, for all of the needs that we have before us, and not get caught up, Lord, in trying to build our own kingdom here on earth, but on yours as well, Lord. Give us this faith that when we look at the scriptures and we memorize promises of God, that even though they might be unfulfilled in our life, that we still cling to them as though they were certain and sure, because they are. And at the end of the day, Lord, help us to be more mindful of where we're going than where we are, that there truly is a city, Father, whose architect and whose builder, whose foundations are all built not by the hands of men, not with their tainted desires and motivations, but there is a city in heaven, a new Jerusalem that is laid apart for those who love, who are called according to the purposes of God, who are believers in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And we long for that day, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, please. Amen. Thank you so much. I'm going to ask our elders to come forward as we receive communion at this time, please. Father, we thank you so much for the bread that we are to receive. Jesus used it as a symbol of his body. He came into this world perfect, Father, without blemish or without stain. And he was broken for us so that we who are broken could be made whole. And so, Father, we give you thanks for this bread of the earth, Lord. We thank you that it provides the spiritual nourishment into our bodies as followers of Jesus. We ask it in Jesus' name as well. Father, we also thank you for this cup. We ask, Father, that you would bless the fruit of the vine, that you would, Father, make it the cleansing agent that it needs to be to cleanse us from sin and make us as white as snow. And for that, we give you thanks as well. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, please. Paul said on the night that Jesus was to be betrayed, that he took bread. And I said this to a number of my senior saints this week, because it captured me. Thank you, Jeff.
Jesus gave thanks, knowing that within a few hours he was going to be what? He was going to be murdered. That to me amazes me. In essence, he was saying, thank you, God, for the plan to be broken so that especially my brothers who are here with me tonight could be made whole. They're not going to understand it, but they will. And so will everyone else that comes to me by faith, believing that what I've done on the cross, being broken, shedding my blood for them, will be the promise fulfilled. And so as we take this bread together, let us think about those places that we are still broken, where we still struggle. And let us offer those things up to God this morning and ask for deliverance, ask for healing, ask for wholeness. Let us do that as we take the bread that Jesus offers us this morning.
Thank you.
is a fountain filled with blood flowing from Emmanuel's veins. What a great old hymn of the faith. Jesus, Paul said that Jesus said on the night that he was going to be betrayed, "This is the new covenant that I'm making with you in my blood. As often as you do this, remember me. Remember my death until I come. Remember that your sins are forgiven, that they are as white as snow." Church, once again, I just want to remind you, I've been in ministry long enough to know that there are folks who sit in church and they just can't believe that God would forgive their sin. And they say, "Pastor, you don't know what I've done." And I want to say, but God does. And there's not a sin in this world that God will not forgive, with the exception of the sin of unbelief in his Son, Jesus Christ. So whatever you're wrestling with, whatever you think that God cannot cleanse and forgive, I want to tell you that the blood of Christ is so effective that it will make you as white as snow, that every sin shall be cleansed if you just confess it and offer it up to God. And all God's people said,
"Yes."
Amen. Wow, what power that is, and what joy we have as we celebrate that together. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for the blood of Christ. As Psalm 103 says, "As far as the east is from the west, I will remember your sin no more." David was overjoyed in Psalm 32 when he wrote, "Blessed is the man whose sins are forgiven, whose transgressions are covered." And we are indeed blessed today, Father, because of what Christ has done and because we have believed by faith. So we thank you, Father, and we remember his death until he comes. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us take the blood of Christ together, shall we? Amen. Thank you so much, elders. I'm going to ask you to stand, if you would, please. We're going to sing an old hymn of the faith, hymn 271, if you need it. It's a very, very familiar song, and we're just going to sing this together because it's really about what Abraham was talking about, just standing on those promises. Let's do that together. Let's sing it out, shall we? Thanks for your goodness.